Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for the new screensavers is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. The new screensavers is brought to you by Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. When it comes to the big decision of choosing a mortgage lender, work with one that has your best interest in mind. Use Rocket Mortgage for a transparent, trustworthy home loan process that's completely online at QuickenLoans.com/NSS. And by Curry, a real live robot with a great personality. Curry is available for pre-order now at HeyCurry.com. That's HeyKurri.com.
Pocket-sized 4K camera, the new Raspberry Pi Zero W, and the best Wi-Fi mesh, live from the Twitty Science Studio in beautiful Petaluma. It's the new Screensavers!
Screensavers. Hey, Father Robert.
Hi. I'm not sure if I'm speaking to Puppet Leo or Real Leo.
This is my Nicole Kidman clap.
All I need
is a 14-carat diamond ring, and I'm...
Those nails are expensive.
It was the ring. She had a big, honking big ring.
Yeah, you don't want to hurt that.
Anyway, welcome to the new Screensavers. This is episode 95 for the 11th day of March, 2017. I'm Leo Laporte with Father Robert Ballecer.
Yay!
I always love when we can have you on.
It's
Digital
it's
Jesuit.
Fun. I get to hang out with Leo. I get to do new screensavers. This is the show I grew up with, and it's a spiritual succession. So, hey.
That's nice.
What's not like to love?
So, I don't know if you saw our triangulation interview on Monday with Mark Rogers. He's SecOps for DEF CON.
Oh.
15 years
oh,
he's
yes,
been doing
yes.
that. And he said, if you want, I'll give you a tour of DEF CON. Now, normally we send you, because we figure the safest thing to do to send to the hacker conference is send a priest, right? I mean, but I would really enjoy going
you
down
should
there.
Go.
Maybe we should. Well, the
you,
two of us could do well, something with Mark. He could give us a tour.
This will be the first year in about two decades that I will have missed DEF CON.
Oh, you can't go?
I can't go. I will be,
oh,
in,
you'll be
silence.
In Malta.
I'll be in silence when this happens.
Oh,
yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, but no, you should go and hang out.
They're not going to let you talk?
No.
For how long?
2 months.
What? Do you want to borrow the puppet?
I can be silent. I've done it.
We have a great show coming up. You are going to show us if we can get it working. It was working yesterday.
It was.
This is the new $10 Raspberry Pi W. It's the Zero W, which adds to their least expensive Raspberry Pi Wi-Fi and Bluetooth.
Correct. Yeah, they had the $5 Zero, which got everyone excited. But the problem was that it used OTG, so you had to have a lot of dongles hanging off this thing. You needed keyboard, you needed mouse,
right.
You needed networking. They wrapped in Bluetooth and Wi-Fi now, and it's actually pretty decent.
It has a HDMI port and everything.
Yeah.
It's kind of amazing. We also have a couple of calls for help, both of them from the UK. One of them is going to answer the long-standing question, how many holes it takes to fill the Albert Hall?
Five.
I don't know. We'll find out. We're also going to talk to Jason Howell. He has found the best headphones he's ever used. Now, Jason is an audiophile, serious guy. He says, right? He wants to keep them. We're not going to let him. The best headphones he's ever used. Megan Morrone will show us more about her bullet journal. But first, we got to start with the news of the week. And, of course, it's all anybody could talk about on the radio show today, on the radio show. It's Vault 7. This is the WikiLeaks dump of 8,000-plus pages of CIA hacking tools. Probably should say alleged CIA hacking tools,
yeah,
but
it's a safe
it's pretty
bet.
Credible.
It's a safe bet. I mean, when you're looking at this quote-unquote treasure trove, you could look at it and say, yeah, okay, I could see them using these tools. There's nothing in there that's really outlandish. In fact, there's a lot of information in this release, in this dump, that is incredibly outdated.
I'd be nervous about following WikiLeaks' interpretation of this,
right.
Because we know Julian Assange and WikiLeaks seems to have a political agenda and seems to have had for some time. But if you read the 8,712 pages Ian Thompson did for the Register, you get a kind of fairly good collection. A couple of the things that got people's attention. First of all, some early reports said that the CIA had cracked Open Whisper's signal messaging.
Right.
They had cracked WhatsApp, which uses Signal, or Open Whisper systems, and they had cracked Telegram. We want to say very clearly up front that is not the case.
So much panic on that.
In fact, a tweet from Open Whisper systems said, you know, what we saw in these documents was, if the CIA can compromise your phone, then they can capture your secret messages before encryption. But of course, that's always been the case.
Right. And that's really been, if you look through the documents, because I've perused through maybe half of them, the tools that they're talking about are ways to exploit devices. It's not like going back to Prism, where it was a huge government program to intercept all traffic and be able to decrypt in real time with a man-in-the-middle attack. This is, well, of course, this is what the CIA, this is what the NSA do. They're trying to do electronic infiltration.
Right.
So their toolkit is, how can I infect your laptop, your desktop, your mobile device? Now, that's not great. I don't like the fact that they're doing that, but this was not an aha moment. This was for the IT people. We covered this on Twiat yesterday. It was sort of a, well, yeah, of course, yeah, we've known that those are out there.
Who wouldn't expect spy agencies, not just ours, but theirs, yeah, to be doing these kinds of tools? But there are some questions raised. First of all, as I mentioned, you can still trust Signal, WhatsApp.
Yes.
I never said you could trust Telegram. They're using their own encryption, which has never been proven reliable. But if you're using Signal, Open Whisper Systems tweeted and Edward Snowden retweeted, A, that they've not been cracked, and B, this shows why governments are doing all these other expensive targeted tools. And that's an important word, targeted tools, because they cannot crack these strong, secure encryption technologies. So what they do is they create compromising tools that allow them to compromise phones, to compromise TVs, other paths to get the data before you send it encrypted. A lot of attention on the Samsung. They had a few Samsung TVs that they were able to hack in such a way that the light wouldn't turn on, the TV would appear to be off, and yet it'd be able to watch and listen. But as far as I could tell, and I read that one fairly closely, they didn't say anything about a remote exploit.
Right.
My guess is that they had to actually get that software on the Samsung TV because they had access to it. Now, I got to point out, if the CIA has access to your television, they probably also have buried stuff in the walls, in the ceiling, in the lights, in the phones. The TV's the least of it. And if they had a remote exploit, that would be a little more concerning.
Those reports started coming out about 6 years ago. I can remember at Interop. And at that point, they were talking mostly about China, how China had access to the factories that were creating the electronics we used. And then someone just asked the question, well, couldn't they just be infecting these from the factory?
Sure.
It said, yes, absolutely. If they have access to the hardware, they can do anything they want. But from an IT perspective, looking at this, the biggest concern out of the documents was the fact that exploits that should no longer be working are still working just fine. Heartbleed, which we covered more than a year ago, is still found in the wild.
Right.
There's no reason why that should be. And so it's sort of like, well, why would they have to do all the targeted exploits if they can just rely on people being lazy and not patching their gear?
Here's the, in my opinion, the only real, we didn't learn anything.
Yeah.
These are exploits. They're 3 years old. We would expect the CIA and other spy agencies to have. I mean, you could debate, well, should the United States be in the cyber spying business? That's a legitimate debate. I think most people agree that if we've, that's part of warfare, as part of national security, is, you know, spying. And of course they're going to develop cyber tools because that's how most people communicate these days. But there was, I think, a very important question that I think you and I and all the tech press should cover, which is, when did the CIA know that these tools have been compromised? Because once the tools get out in the wild, then it's not the CIA that's a threat. It's the run-of-the-mill script kiddie and hacker and organized crime. If they have access to these tools, and there's some evidence the CIA might have known about this at least a year ago, then it's incumbent, I think, on the company that created the tools, no matter how much they want to keep these tools around because they're useful, they've got to tell the companies, Samsung or Apple or Google or whoever, hey, we found an exploit. Here's the exploit. It's in the wild now. Fix it. Now, I understand the CIA spent a lot of money and time and energy and hired a lot of hackers to create these tools, but there will always be new tools. There's no unexploitable software in the world anywhere, except maybe Signal. And even then, you know, there will be holes in Signal. And so they're going to continue to create these tools, and they can't hold on so tight to the tools once they've leaked out into the wild. So I think that there is a burden on whoever creates these tools. I mean, we know this doesn't happen. Celebrate was just hacked, right?
Yep.
Celebrate had a whole bunch of, a slew of Apple and other exploits that allowed them to break into phones. They didn't tell Apple. They didn't say, hey, we've got a problem, because this is their business. They sell to the highest bidder. Sometimes our government, sometimes their government, sometimes governments that don't respect human rights. All of these are cause for concern, but I don't think this has raised the level of concern.
No, and it really does, because this is not a government surveillance issue. This is the issue of, what do you do as a responsible IT electronic generation citizen? What do you do if you discover a zero day? Because right now, a zero day is worth a lot of money.
It's tempting to sell it.
Yeah, to governments, to bad actors. So if you've done the work, to get that research, you could be responsible. There are many entities out there who will submit these bugs, and they'll make sure that it's reported responsibly before releasing their code. And there are others who will say, well, I'm not going to let go of a $500,000 bug.
Right.
That's just silly.
And in fact, I think that we should be realists and assume that governments will not notify companies and have them fix their code any more than private entities will. So what do we do? That was, I thought, where you were going. What do we as citizens do to protect ourselves?
Encrypt everything.
As best you can.
I truly believe encrypt. There are those who are saying, no, only encrypt the important stuff. No. Everything that you can do to encrypt
your
traffic.
That's a red flag.
Because then it says, oh, that's the important stuff because it's encrypted. Let's spend the time to crack it. If you encrypt every bit of communication coming out of your network, you'll take a tiny little performance hit, and you encourage the people around you who are connected to your network to do the same. That's how you start a movement, by saying, hey, you know what? This is a pain the first time you set it up, and then it's just going to become commonplace.
Yeah. I did hear something very encouraging from Mark Rogers, who was our guest on, as I mentioned, the last Monday on Triangulation. DEFCON SecOps. He's also a security guy for, chief of security for Cloudflare. He's a well-known hacker. He's a car hacker. He's a brilliant guy. I said, doesn't the NSA have all the intercepts for all the conversations that occurred during the election, he said, no. He said, they collect everything. We can assume they collect everything. No one can store all that data. I said, even with their new data center in Utah, he said, you don't understand how much data there is. It's petabytes a day. You can only store it, he said, for about a month. Now, you can then say, all right, we're going to keep an eye on Father Robert, so we'll make sure we keep all of his stuff. But they can't keep the vast amount of data that they're collecting forever. They run out of space.
It was about 6 years ago where we passed the point at which there was more data in transit on the internet than was in storage. I mean, just think about that. It means that at any given time, bouncing around our routers, bouncing around our ISPs, there's more data being moved from one place to another that's actually physically stored on a SSD or a hard drive somewhere. That's too much. You would forever be building a data center in order to store all that.
Yeah.
So what they can do is they can start storing things like metadata, and we've had long discussions about that. They can start looking at people of interest, but you're absolutely right. It's not as if they can go back 3 years and pull up a single phone call that one person did to another person when those two people weren't even on the intelligence map.
The internet traffic, the global internet traffic.
What is it right now?
It's increased fivefold in the last 5 years, and according to a guest by the Telegraph, it's going to reach 2,000 petabytes. What's the next thing above a petabyte? A zettabyte? So that's 2 zettabytes. And it will double again by 2019.
That's about right.
So there's a lot of traffic.
How much of that is Netflix?
41%. Not kidding.
That's actually it. Netflix and YouTube. Netflix, YouTube, Amazon, Hulu, that's probably about 70%.
Yeah. Video streaming is 41% of all internet data this year, 54% by 2019. So
NSA, if you want to intercept my encrypted Netflix streams,
please
enjoy.
And you know, people who are worried about their Samsung TV, I guess if you want to put a piece of tape over the camera, go right ahead. But the truth is, if you're targeted, there's not much you can do to protect yourself. And if you're not targeted, and most of us are not targeted, you can live life as if, you know, they didn't have these capabilities. I wish we could say, oh yeah, ban all spying, ban all cyber security, patch yourself, and you never have to worry about it again. But that's just not going to be the case.
There is one surefire way to secure your computer and all your digital
data. Throw out all of it.
Yeah. Unplug it, throw it away, make sure it's crushed.
I'm not doing that. So, in fact, I just got a new one.
Ooh.
A new way to spy on me. Look at this blue. This is
that
nice.
That thing is sexy.
So I saw the ad for this. Oh, look at all the fingerprints on it. This is the...
It's a little bit of a...
Let's clean that up there.
Fingerprint magnet.
Well, it is a fingerprint magnet. Look at it. It's a beautiful blue glass back. This is the HTC U Ultra. They make a black one, a white pearl opalescent, and this is the blue. I like the blue. $750.
It doesn't come through on camera, but it's not just reflective. It's a deep reflective. It has depth to it. It just really looks nice.
The pearl is, I almost wish I'd gotten the pearlescent because it really is beautiful. HTC is desperately trying to stay alive in what has become a two-horse race, Samsung and Apple, at least at the high end. HTC announced just a month ago that they weren't going to make low-end phones anymore. They're going to stick with the high end. I have a soft spot for HTC. I remember the HTC One. I loved it. It was the greatest phone ever.
They've had a few good ones.
They've struggled since. They do make the Pixel for Google. Mm-hmm. They made the Nexus 6P for Google. So we know they make some good hardware. This is very familiar for people who are using, well, any smartphone these days. In fact, I'll put it right next to my iPhone 7S Plus. It's roughly the same size width, but it's a slightly bigger screen because they have smaller bezels than the iPhone. This is a 5.7-inch screen, very high resolution. It's quad HD. I think it's quite beautiful. They're using, I can't remember if they're using, I think they're using the 821, the Snapdragon nice. 821 processor. You'll notice this, though, there's a separate screen, little tiny bar up on the top there that you can customize. So I have contacts, calendars, I can play music through it. And if I stop the music, go back home and hide the music player, I still get controls up at the top there. Get weather. This is completely customizable. I think it's quite great in icons.
I love that because it is not an extension of the screen. If you notice, the camera bump is right there.
Yeah.
So it is literally a separate piece of glass.
Yeah. In fact, I can tap it or double tap it. Let's see.
Come back.
It's going to...
It's got performance anxiety.
I can shake it.
There we go.
And it's got a little low power always on mode. So I like this. It's got a fingerprint reader at the bottom. It's almost identical to Apple's. It's non-moving. It's just like a home button. And notice the capacitive touch light up back and recents buttons. Those are on the bezel there. So those are completely out of the way. But there's some other, they call it the U phone for you. We were playing with the selfie. It's got a 16 megapixel selfie camera. And it has a wide mode selfie, which is we were playing with. And it's kind of fun here. Father Robert had a little bit of fun with me. By getting it all.
Many minds.
That's a panoramic selfie, which I kind of like. It also brings back one of the things I loved about the HTC, which is the 3-second Zoe. It's both a video and stills, kind of like Apple's Live Photos. And HTC used to have, and I suppose you could probably find, tools that would... What's wrong with you? Tools that would allow you to edit this, create slideshows, and modify it. I think it's an excellent camera. I'm very pleased. But what phone doesn't have an excellent camera these days? All the top-of-the-line phones' cameras are pretty good. There's one other thing this does that's very interesting. HTC's always been known for high-quality audio. I'm sad to say they've got rid of the front side speakers. Oh. That was the great thing about the HTC One. But they do something interesting. No headphone jack. It's Type-C. It comes with Type-C headphones. You can buy for a few dollars, and I did, an adapter that lets you use your regular analog headphones with a Type-C adapter. But I want you to try something. Let me untangle my headphones. This is, by the way, the real reason for wireless headphones is tangles. Somebody estimated to spend about 5 hours a week doing this.
Yeah, but how many hours a week will you spend finding your earbuds?
Yeah, right. So I'm going to plug this in. This is what's really interesting. I'm going to let you do this.
Okay.
And you can be an unbiased reporter. It has this feature that lets you customize the sound of the phone so that you get, I'm an older guy, right? So the high end is falling off, the low end's falling off. You get a customized audio experience, which is, I think, kind of wild. You want to try that?
Okay.
Okay.
So what is this going to do? Is this scanning my brain?
Yeah, kind of. It's called the HTC U Sonic. Go ahead, put those headphones in. Okay. Get them left and right. And now on Samsung, we've seen this before. It does a hearing test, like an audiologist does, and you go, yeah, I can hear that tone. I can't hear that tone. That takes a while, and it works. But this is amazing. I'm gonna create a personal audio profile. Okay. What this is going to do? I'm going to do it right now. You heard some white noise.
I did.
Just a blast of white noise. That's all it did. And then now it's scanned. That's all it did. Look at this is your curve. Your high end is terrible.
Wait,
by the way,
it
doesn't look anything like my curve. Blue is left, red is right. This is the enhanced sound, what it would normally sound like
to
a teenager.
What did it just do?
No, okay, wait a minute. Now put them back in. This is the audio without it on. Okay. This is the audio with it on. You can't hear this at home, folks. But you tell me, Father Robert. Sounds a lot better, doesn't it?
That's when you toggle that, I lose all the highs.
Yeah, it sounds muddy. So I have to say, I don't know how accurate this is. It could be completely pseudoscience, right? I do have my own hearing curve. I know, it just blasts a little white noise. It takes that long. It sounds like...
Okay, I need to know the science, because...
I would like to know, too. They say they're mapping your ear chamber or something. I don't know, some sort of BS.
Because I've had my ear chamber mapped, but it was with a laser scope.
I know.
Not with an earbud.
Okay, but you got to admit, it sounds better,
right?
It
does, it does.
And it's not typical loudness. For instance, yours, your low end is actually pretty good. Mine is much lower than that. You and I have similar high-end roll-off, but that's normal with age, right? My curve looks very different from this, and... I'm going to have to take it home and compare it to my actual audiologist hearing curve. But as I remember it, it looks very close to what the audiologist measured in an hour-long hearing test.
You got to bring this into your audiologist and say, hey, I don't
How do it know? So it's an interesting concept. And, of course, nobody wants to go through a hearing test. Yeah. Samsung actually buries theirs. They call it adapt sound deep within the settings. This... is very easy, very fast, and produces, I think, a very good result.
I can't argue against that. It did sound better when you toggled it. So something's working right, but I mean, I really need to know the science behind it, other than I played half a second of white noise, and now I know what you can hear.
How do it know? I'm gonna name this Father Robert.
It's so science,
the other thing is you can have multiple, it's nice, you can have multiple profiles. So anytime you want to borrow my phone, you've got your own profile.
Now, I have to do it with those earbuds, right?
Okay. These are Type-C, so that means there's data going on, right? That's more than just analog headphones. You couldn't do this with analog headphones, whatever it's doing.
What I don't want to hear is that that was actually like a microwave emitter and it just shot a bunch of radiation through my brain. Because I really can't spare the brain cells.
I wish I could show you my curve, because unfortunately, after you do the curve, you can't. But go ahead. We could play some sound.
So I'm hearing it like Leo hears.
You're going to hear Father Roberts, and then I'm going to play my profile in here. This is going to be Charlie XCX. Is that how you pronounce
it? All right, hit it. So this is me.
This is you.
Okay.
Now it's me. Does it sound different?
Okay.
You. Me.
Whoa.
Right? Because my hearing's worse.
Yours is really muted. I lose everything up top.
There you go. I don't know why.
All right. Well, so it does
you
something.
You have terrible high-end, by the way. I just want to warn you.
That's fine.
Your high-end is terrible. So, $750, 64 gigs of storage. It's unlocked. HTC U Ultra.
I'm looking for a new phone. That could be it. I mean, if I could sell it to my superior saying, look, I need to scan my ears.
What I like is, because they know this is a fingerprint magnet of the worst kind, it comes with a little plastic shell in the box that you can add to this. So anyway, HTC U Ultra. It's a little first look. I just got it today, so I'll have to give you a better review.
Not bad.
Are you ready for our first call for help?
I love it.
Let's do it! I got so excited when I saw John was going to be on the line. Hi, John.
Howdy.
Because he's calling from a very, very famous town. Blackburn, Lancashire.
Yep, that's right.
You know why it's famous, right? Because it has 400 holes. It's the Beatles song. Now we know how many holes it takes to fill the Albert Hall. Anyway, it's before your time.
Pass a certain age, I think.
don't worry about it. What can we do for you, John?
I'm in the market for a new NAS. I've currently got a messenger to MacBook, but I mainly use iOS for my main computer. I've got an iPad Pro and an iPhone SE. So I'm just wondering your thoughts on what NAS should I get. I mainly do a YouTube channel for video editing, so I use iMovie on the iPad, and document storage and stuff like that. And I also want to be able to take notes, but not put it on like Google Keep, because I want to keep it with my...
We got a good solution for you.
Home music. I don't want to stream.
And by the way, we have the guy, the king of the NAS here.
That's what I do, yeah.
NAS stands for, I'll just give you the basics, network. You know this, John, but for everybody else, a network attached storage. The idea is it's a headless computer. Mm-hmm. It's a computer with a lot of storage, usually redundant storage, that is connected to your network and automatically shared to your entire network. No keyboard, mouse, and monitor, but you maintain it, you run it via a browser from one of the computers on your network. And I've used, I like ReadyNAS from Netgear. I think those are great. We've mentioned in the past NAS solutions from
We got Netgear, we got QNAP.
QNAP is the one I was going to talk about. It's a lot of people do their own with FreeNAS. Drobo has a NAS solution. But Father Robert is a complete Synology fanatic. And you know what? You made me a Synology fanatic.
It works.
And because you mentioned you want to replace your notes capability, I wanted to do the same thing once Evernote started to raise its price. And I got concerned about storing personal stuff on the cloud. I thought, why don't I run my own cloud? And this is one thing that, one of many things Synology is very, very good at. So give us the pitch.
I'll give you the pitch. But first, you know, John, I'm going to have to translate for you because we have Americans who don't understand true English. You have a Western Digital right now, which is fantastic.
What are you doing in there? Start over. I didn't see that.
You're using a Western Digital right now, which is a decent NAS. It's a bit on the lower end. It's a bit slower. Specifically, what you asked for is you wanted something that you could use with your mobile, something that had the ability to store notes, like we do with, say, Google Docs. And also, you wanted to maybe have something that could help you with production to your YouTube channel. Well,
the problem I've always had with the Western Digital is it's really just a way for them to sell hard drives.
It really is.
So it has a little software layer on top of what is basically a USB drive.
Right, right.
Do they even have multi-drive solutions?
They have. They're black. Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, there are...
I use Western Digital drives in my Synology. Yep. Nothing wrong with that. You're going to be seeing me do this a lot over the next 6 months, cleaning the back of my phone. But I think that if you really want to take advantage of RAID 5 or even better solutions than RAID, there are better ways to do that than Western
Digital. Way better. Yeah, Western Digital, Netgear, those I kind of put on the same level. Above that, you've got Drobo. But at the top, the two that I trust the most, that I like the most, that I've played with the most, are QNAP and Synology. And QNAP is nice. They've got great hardware, but Synology does edge them out in the software, in the operating system.
Oh, man.
It's so good.
We're talking about DSM.
DSM.
Which is the Synology. It's both an operating system and a way of installing additional plugins. They have a very broad range of plugins. Here we've got some Synology NASs. Father Robert's dragging them out
here.
We got
toys.
So you can go with a two-drive solution. That's if, you know, because remember, you got to not only buy the enclosure, but you got to buy the drives. But then they have multi-drive. I have a five-drive Synology NAS. It's the same as this, I think. Is this the 18, what is this?
This is the 1515
Plus. 1515
Plus.
Right. This is the one I have at home.
A little older. Mm. Yeah, so the nice thing about this is, because you mentioned that you wanted to be able to work with your mobile device. They actually have apps that work specifically with Synology. Synology's done so much development on the back end. And their plugin system is second to none. So if you wanted to do VPN, if you wanted to have a fantastic way to store notes that are private to you, you could do that with just this.
This is DS Note. It's running on my iPhone. I have it on the Android as well. I have it on the desktop computer. This is fantastic because it's just like Evernote.
Oh, yeah.
You could put pictures. You could put all sorts of stuff in it. You could sort it, search it. But you're storing it on your NAS. You're not storing it on the public cloud. It's encrypted in transit, encrypted in place, and you have access to it everywhere, just as you would Keep or Evernote. I love that. That's just, but that's one of 100 things you can do.
Yeah, and basically,
that's one of the main things I'm after.
I want to give you two options here because this is the 1515 Plus, and it's been supplanted. There's a faster one now, but these five bay models. Going to typically run you close to $700 diskless, and then you have to fill it up with disk. I would fill it up with the Western Digital Red drives. Those are designed for NAS, fantastic. They last forever. This has so much performance. We're talking about a quad-core processor, 2 gigabytes of memory that you can expand. These are all hot swap. It's got 4 gigabit Ethernet ports in the back, plus USB 3, USB 2. I can use this as a Docker machine if I want to run containers. I can expand
it. Does it have enough horsepower? Because it's an Atom processor.
It's
can
an Atom.
I run Docker on here?
Yes,
really?
Absolutely.
I mean, I know you can, but does it run well?
I run it. In fact, right now, the way that my system works is when I'm at home, browsers don't open up on my laptop. Containers that are run on this open up on my laptop, so I never have to worry about getting it infected.
See, I run this as simply as possible. I have as few installations as possible, partly for speed, but also for security. Because if you turn on SSH, well, now you have another place a bad guy can attack you. So I just use it for the notes and the backup. It also does photos. It'll do media sharing. You can run your WordPress
surveillance station.
Blog on
you
it.
Can you could have
surveillance.
An IP camera network on this thing.
Yeah.
Now, if you don't want that, if that's too much.
That's the other thing I want to do, but it's photo backup.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, it's great. I have everything backing up to this. What I did is I have three terabyte drives, and I had two. This is what I had lying around, two terabyte drives. Mm-hmm. So that's a total of 13 terabytes. And then I have two disk redundancy. So any two disks can fail without data loss. I still get about 9 gigabytes of storage, terabytes, I'm sorry, of storage on here. That's more than enough for backing up all my machines,
right.
for storing all my notes. If I were putting media on here, I might want to add more. But you can always add more storage. It's hot swappable, right?
And Gary in our chat room wants to know what OS it's running, and it's Linux. It's DSM, but it's on a variant of Linux.
Is it?
Yeah. So yeah. it's you can write your own plugins. It's very, very solid.
They update regularly. That's really important too. You don't want to be kind of beholden to a company and have them not keep their stuff up to date, but I'd get regular DSM updates.
Not only are they really good about updating their software, but you can auto-update. So you can have it set up, so when you're sleeping, it will just update itself.
Who are these guys, though? I mean,
can it notify your mobile device when it's updating? When it's been updated, it's out of date. Will it update your mobile device?
Yes, because it's an app. So on the mobile device, you're just running standard apps, mm-hmm. which update the way a regular App Store app would update. So you don't have to worry about
that. I mean, if there's no devices out of date, really alert your phone that it's out of date.
Yeah.
And you can
manage I get notifications.
Yeah.
But it'll auto-update. Sometimes you have to restart, in which case you'll get a notification, then you just restart. I get emails every day. I get emails on my hard drive state, whether the hard drives are okay, whether there's an update needed, when I connected it to my UPS. By the way, it understands UPSs as well. So I just plugged in a UPS via USB, and now if the power goes out in my house, this thing will automatically fail over. It'll notify me. I mean, it's hard. We sound like an ad for this thing, but the more I dig into it, the more I like it.
Yeah.
Now, if you wanted to build your own, you'd get a beige box, put FreeNAS on it, and you'd have many of these same capabilities.
It works, but the problem with FreeNAS is it uses a lot more in power. It doesn't update quite as quickly. And this is the idiot box. You just turn this thing on, it goes.
It depends on how do-it-yourself you want.
Yeah, and if you don't want to spend $700, you've got this. This is the 2-drive unit. It still uses an Intel processor. It's slightly slower. It's a dual core instead of a quad core. But this thing goes for about $250.
And it's all the same DSM capabilities,
exactly.
Right?
That's what I really like about the Synology line, which is if you learn the operating system on one, you know the operating system on all of them, from the least expensive to the most expensive. It's a really good ecosystem to be in.
Does it do something like a Google Docs replacement as well?
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's built in.
So it has a word processor,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
I can't remember. It has a spreadsheet.
Yeah. If you watch Know How, so I have a show called Know How.
You can run your own mail server.
Yeah, exactly. You can do a secure mail server. You could do a relay. You could do chat. You could do your own office. And it's all hosted on your device. And if you want to, it'll also be hosted on the Synology service. So you can do a hybrid thing. You'll never, ever go down. It's really a great solution.
I should also mention I have 2-factor turned on, so I feel like it's fairly secure.
Yep.
I not only need a password, I need to add a 6-digit 2-factor, which I use a standard authenticator for. You can have 2 of these if you really want to spend money. And then, by the way, there's lots of ways to spend money because you can also put more RAM in this thing, up to 6 gigs of RAM memory, and more memory means it'll be more responsive for multiple users. I think for a single user, you're probably okay with it out of the box. But you can also get a second one at the office, and they can automatically sync with each other, so you could have a duplicate off-site, so then you're really secure, right? Your data is duplicated in 2 different places. You've got the redundancy of the multiple drives. I feel like they've really thought it out, but I have my question again for you. Who the hell are these people, and should I trust them? Who is Synology? Is it an American company?
They're located in Fremont.
What?
Yeah, they're just down the road a little bit.
All right.
Yeah.
I should know this, right? Like, is this company in China writing this stuff? So they write it all themselves.
They write it all themselves, and you can get the distro from them if you want to play around with DSM. They also have...
Wait a minute. You could put it on your own beige box?
You could poke it around with it, because it is just Intel hardware.
Right.
It will not work nearly as well. I mean,
They've tuned it for this.
This is one of those few companies where the hardware and the software, they've tuned both of them. It's not a beige box that they've slapped their name on it.
Right.
It actually is very well made.
Notice they're using BTRFS, which is a CAU file system. This is it's sometimes used in Linux. It's kind of cutting edge. It's the B-tree file system. But I have to say, that you want as well, because it's very robust. It'll automatically heal itself if there's errors. It's copy on write means if the power goes out, it survives. It checks each sector with a CRC to make sure that there's no data corruption. This is a really nice modern file system. I'd love to see ZFS, but this is the next best thing. What they have done is very impressive. I keep looking for flaws. I keep looking for something. Look, it does Active Directory. I keep looking for things to hate because it's too easy. While this is the high price spread, it's not cheap.
Ooh, USB copper.
Yeah, look at that. Isn't that awesome? Because it has a USB port in the back.
Have we sold you yet? Because we have to apply also for a commission.
I should point out, it also has eSATA, two eSATA ports on the 1515 Plus. That means you could put an external hard drive on here.
Well, they also have external cases, so you can actually put 15 drives on this one unit. They have
expansion bays. Oh, that's what these are for. These are for expansion.
The expansion bays.
Oh,
yeah.
That's nice. So you can put a second bay on top.
Now, I have about a dozen of these things in my shop right now, and I have not lost a single one, and I love it. I mean, I've switched everything over. I used to be heavy on the Netgear. Now I'm all Synology.
You might ask why it has four Ethernet ports.
Oh, yes. You can bond those together because the total speed of this array is actually more than what you can get out of a single gigabit Ethernet pipe.
So you put a couple of gigabits on here, and you can have more.
Yeah,
wow.
Exactly.
Wow. It's kind of overbuilt.
Really? It is. But we like that.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, I fought this for years. I used everything else. Father Robert, Andy Yanako, Renee Ritchie, so many of the people we work with, everybody's kind of quiet about it, but everybody knows Synology. And as soon as I said, oh yeah, I got a Synology, they said, well, finally. So it is expensive, but I'm very happy with this. And I feel like I have a total personal cloud.
Yep.
And I've tried everything, even the little boxes that you plug in, the pogo plugs and all that stuff. Nothing. This is set it and forget it. I would get a UPS if your power is unreliable. I got a small UPS that has continuous power, which is nice, so there's no failover, there's no interruption. And that way, this continues, but because it connects via USB, when the UPS starts to run out of battery, it will tell the Synology, okay, I'm not going to keep you going. You should shut down now, so it has an orderly shutdown. So I feel like I've got this rock-solid data solution in my closet. Yeah. That was a bit of a self-job.
That's all you want, isn't it?
Yeah. What about YouTube editing? I don't know. You couldn't use this for editing, could you? It's not fast enough for that.
No, you wouldn't.
The way I do a YouTube channel for Xbox.
Ah, what's the name of your channel?
The Xbox.
What's the name of your channel?
W. McCannover, Centifier.
Okay.
W. McVinny, Centifier. It's about Star Trek Online.
Nice.
I play Star Trek Online. So I got a box which I capture to a USB stick.
Oh, okay.
And so this would be fine for backup and for storage, for sure, yeah. Oh, and you use USB copy,
What I want to do is, I want to use a USB copy to plug it onto a NAS, and then I can copy that onto my iPad to edit it, plug on YouTube, then copy it back over onto the NAS when it's finally done.
I think you'll be very happy with this.
Instead of using my computer.
It's really just about money.
Yeah.
Because it's not a cheap solution.
But it's the best solution.
I spent so much money on all the little piecemeal solutions that by the time I got to this, I thought this was worth it.
The only other question I've got is, what about the power? How much power do you use compared to a cut down PC or something?
Well, you got five, it depends what you get, but if you've got five drives running in here and they're spinning all the time.
I have my 1515, which is running Reds, which run cool and they run a little slower.
They're 5400 RPM.
They're 5400 RPM drives. When my 1515 is at full crank, I'm pulling about 65 watts.
That's not bad.
It's less than a light bulb. Yeah.
So it's a lot cheaper than a PC then.
Way cheaper for continuous usage. A piece, like if I were to make a free NAS that did the same thing, it'd probably be pulling about 150 watts.
Yeah, that's what I was on about.
Yeah, because you don't want these to sleep, obviously. Yeah. They need to be on a high demand servers. So. Is this the latest 1515 Plus?
No, they have a newer one, but again, the price is up. And this was my spare unit. That's what I had in my closet I could
spare
bring in.
Spare unit. I practically had to hawk the bank on this one, but I'm very happy with it. And just look at all the things you can do with the DSM. That's just amazing.
You're going to like it.
Their software is incredible.
Yeah, I think we're looking at Snowdon, then.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. It's great to talk to you. How many holes again in Lancashire?
Yeah. Oh, I'm going to clear these loads of them.
I heard Blackburn, Lancashire. I thought, wait a minute, I know that town. Oh, yeah, it's a Beatles song. Thank you, John. It's great to talk to you. Take care. Next week, our newest employee, I'm very happy to say. We kind of scored. We stole Nathan Oliveris-Giles from the Wall Street Journal. We've loved Nathan for a long time. He's been on many of our shows. He's hosted here. And we just think he's got a great style, sense of humor. He's a smart guy. And we were very lucky to, we offered him a job, and we were very lucky to have Nathan Oliveris-Giles on our team, one of our staff hosts, along with Father Robert and Jason Howell and Megan Morrone. And he's
going to
really add
to our
coverage.
A couple of episodes.
Well, he does it all, right?
Yeah.
And he's a gamer, too, which is nice. He's a young guy. He'll be here next week. So if you've got questions for Nathan, or Nate, as we call him, or Nog, here's how you can get your questions answered.
Need tech help? The new screensavers are here with answers. Email your tech questions to newscreensavers@twit.tv.
Yeah, one of the things about hiring somebody for a small company like this is you want somebody who will fit the culture.
Oh, yeah.
You do. We want geeks. We want people who just like, you could see Robert's, you know, like enthusiasm. And Nate's one of those people. So we're just thrilled. Thrilled as all get out. Father Robert's going to show us how he designed his new studio with a camera that I've been drooling over for some time from Blackmagic Design. And we've got Jason's favorite headphones ever. That's saying an awful lot from a guy who reviews some of the best. And you know what? I agree with him. I have the same ones. We'll have those in just a second. But first, I want to tell you about Rocket Mortgage. If you're buying a new home or you're refinancing your existing home, there are a couple of things you want to look for in a mortgage lender. You want to find somebody who you can trust, somebody who is really good, and somebody who will make it easy on you. And this is why I really recommend Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. Quicken Loans is easily the best. If you go to quickenloans.com/NSS, you'll see immediately how many customer service awards. They are tops in the J.D. Power customer satisfaction year after year. So going back to 2010, I mean, they're amazing. But they're also geeks. They're geeks at heart, and I love this about them. And so they've created a mortgage approval process that you can do entirely from your phone on your couch or from an open house, for that matter. Let's say you go to an open house tomorrow. You know, we all do. We want to see what the neighbor's house looks like. And you suddenly say, wow, this is a nice house. And they're asking, what? We should buy this. Honey, how can we buy this? You fire up Rocket Mortgage. You go to quickenloans.com/NSS. Answer a few questions. You don't have to go through boxes of paper. You can submit your pay stubs, your check statements, whatever it is they need, with a push of a button. And because it's all computerized, you can do things like, you know, modify the term of the loan or the rate of the loan to get a product that matches you exactly and literally get approval in minutes. A completely online home approval process. You better believe it. Quicken Loans has done it again. Go to quickenloans.com/NSS and use Rocket Mortgage. You know, have this, you know, put it, just keep it in your back of your mind. You never know. You go to an open house, you might be going to quickenloans.com/NSS. We're approved. Equal housing lender, licensed in all 50 states and MLS, consumeraccess.org, number 3030. Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. All right, I've been kind of teasing this, but I kind of agree with Jason. There are different ways to do headphones.
Yes.
And if you are willing to really go, you know, all out, there's a technology called, what is it, electromagnetic planar?
Planar headphones.
Planar magnetic headphones. We gave Jason a pair of the HIFIMAN HE-400i headphones, and he had this report.
I'm here with a pretty rocking pair of headphones. These are the HIFIMAN HE-400i headphones. They're a little big, as you can see, but I'm going to get into it with these because they are using a technology called planar magnetic technology inside. What is that? It's basically, it's like a mix of dynamic and electrostatic drivers inside. Instead of a miniature cone or like a dome that you get with dynamic drivers, planar magnetic uses a large, thin, and flat magnetic diaphragm, which is kind of why it's so wide and flat here. It moves quickly, has awesome transient response. That was one of the first things that I noticed because of all that width. And you can kind of see it in there, see the plate in there. It was super hot in the 70s and the 80s. Now it's coming back in a number of high-end headphones, this being one of them. And I've really enjoyed my time with these headphones. First of all, the design, super solid, substantial. It's a little heavy, but honestly, when I throw it on my head here, you've got these adjustable straps here to account for if you have a big noggin or not. It rests really nicely and it actually distributes the weight pretty evenly so you don't feel like you're wearing a weight the whole time that you have these big headphones on your head. But it has an open back design, so there's audio leakage that happens when you're listening. But it also, kind of the benefit of that is it almost emulates what it sounds like when you're in a room listening to speakers. It lets some of the ambient noise come through as well as the really high quality audio. Low noise on here. The cord is a bit short for my taste. It's around 5.5 feet, which is really short depending on what you're plugging it into. But, you know, your mileage may vary. And a phone can actually drive these. That can't be said for a lot of high-end headphones. You can drive this with your phone, though you might wish that you had a little bit more gain on it. As far as the sound is concerned, stereo imaging is super precise. It's one of the first things that I noticed when I put these on my head. Opened up the detail in my own music. I really use these primarily for mixing some of the music that I'm writing at home. And I was just amazed at what I heard with these that I didn't hear with these AKGs that I've been using for years now, which were fine in their own right, until the HIFIMAN HE-400i's came along and totally shattered my idea of good headphones. Highs are super clear on the high end, maybe a tad harsh at times, but overall very revealing, and especially with that transient response, things just sounded really clear. Mids, I'd say the mids are where it's at. Incredibly transparent, super opaque, side by side with my AKGs. I mean, there's really no comparison in that realm. Things just sounded muddy on my AKGs. Then I put it on here and everything had a lot of detail. And then, of course, the low end, rich, not too overemphasized. So you're not going to get an exaggerated, emphasized low end or bass. More natural sounding than anything. But man, I just heard so much clarity of my bass instruments and things that I hadn't heard before. It was really eye-opening. So overall, with the HIFIMAN HE-400i, you can get it for around $500, though Amazon has them for $350, I noticed this morning. I feel like it's great for mixing, not so good for recording because of the open back design. Also for shared environments, if you're listening to music, other people are going to hear the music that you're listening to. But as for me, I fully intend on picking up a pair of these bad boys because it's going to be really hard for me to go back to the AKGs. I just loved the HIFIMAN HE-400i's that much. I have to get myself a pair. You can catch me on all sorts of shows on the Twit Network. Of course, Tech News Today, all about Android and Android App Arena, and I hope that you do.
We should point out that they cost 10 times more than the AKGs, there is a reason why they sound better. I have their big brothers, the 560s, and the words he kept using, like open and transparent, that's exactly what you hear on planar magnetic. It's hard to describe until you actually hear it.
The worst thing you can do if you are one of these people who truly loves audio quality is to go to a store or to go to like a CES and put on a decent set of planar headphones because then nothing else will do.
Yeah, it spoils you. Yeah, it really does. Thank you. Next week, we're going to give him another audiophile headphone. People often refer to the Audies, A-U-D-E-Z-E. Am I saying that right? Audies, as being the ones to beat. So we'll find out. He's going to wear earbuds from Audies next week with Jason Howell, host of All About Android and, of course, Tech News Today. So you have, before we met you, you were doing video podcasts, you were doing field shoots, you were doing a lot of the same kind of work. And you've always used your own Panasonic camera for these, right?
Yeah, I have a set of Panasonic AG-HMC-150s. They're 10-year-old cameras, but they're 1080p, they do 60 frames a second. They're CCD, not CMOS, so it's really sensitive to low light. I love the richness of the color, I love the balance, but they're not great studio cameras. They're good field cameras because, you know, you've got everything combined. But I wanted something that actually was designed to be inside of a studio, specifically within a podcast studio. So it couldn't be too expensive, it couldn't be too big, and it couldn't be too complicated. I've been waiting a very long time for that. I found it 2 years ago at NAB.
Yes. In fact, we always at NAB, we used to be right next to the Blackmagic booth, and I would always go over there and drool.
Yeah.
And I was very interested in these. The philosophy Blackmagic has with these is a little different because these are basically parts of a camera. You add pieces to this camera. What is this?
So this is the one that I ended up buying for my studio. This is the Blackmagic Studio Micro, or the Micro Studio. There's two versions that look like this. One's called the Cinema, one's called the Studio. This is the Studio. It's really designed for studio. There is no recording capability in this camera.
Okay, that's really important. There is no recording capability.
Right.
You either will add a recorder after the fact, or if you're recording live in the studio, you don't need a recorder. You record it at the switcher. 4K though, right?
4K. So this is a 4K sensor. I believe it's 13 millimeters by 7 millimeters. It's big.
Is that full frame? Is that what we'd call full frame?
That's full. Yeah. And it's a Micro Four Thirds mount.
That's what I find really interesting.
Yeah.
By the way, doesn't come with a lens even.
Does not. So this and a lot of cameras are like this.
But the Micro Four Thirds system is great because no one company owns it. It's a standard, and there are many, many choices. I brought Father Robert several of our lenses from our Olympus OMD cameras, our Micro Four Thirds cameras.
Yeah, this is one
so
of yours.
So you could try them. This is the kit lens that comes with the
OMD. This is not a super expensive piece of glass, but the ability to swap glass makes this an incredible device. In fact, there we go. So let's zoom out.
Better than your Panasonic, for instance. If you want great depth of field, you can get a short lens that has a wide open aperture and get some nice depth of field. If you need telephoto, you could put that on there. You can even, this is a zoom lens, so you can even use, look at that, that's a pretty good picture.
Yeah, and for inexpensive glass, but you're exactly right, because here in the studio, we had to put lenses on some of our Canons. They weren't designed to swap
lenses.
Yeah,
they're really adapters.
So yeah, you're putting a lens on a lens. It does something to the image quality. Here, I can swap out the glass. I can make it really, really short focus. I can make it a fast lens, a slow lens. I can put this thing on. Should I put
that's a really high quality. It's a little too long because it's designed for a Micro Four Thirds sensor, which is a lot smaller than the full frame that's on this. The point, though, it's kind of one of the reasons people use DSLRs nowadays to shoot video, is having interchangeable lenses gives you kind of the professional capabilities of a cinematographer. You're doing more than, oh my gosh, that's a little long.
This might be a little long.
Yeah. You would move the camera farther back.
This is probably not a lens you're going to want to use in your podcast studio.
Well, you could, though, if the camera were over there. Quality is good. You get to pick your own lenses, yes. So you can go cheap at first. And if you decide you really need that great $1,000 lens, you can add that down the road. The variety of lenses on Micro Four Thirds is out of control.
Staggering. Staggering. And the other cool things about this is it's got both HDMI, and on this side, you've got the SDI, the mini SDI.
So pros, we use SDI with our mixer from
precisely
from TriCaster. So SDI is a more professional, long throw choice. But a lot of people have HDMI capabilities, and so you have both.
I get both, and what this allows me to do is I can actually output to both simultaneously at different resolutions. So I can output to the SDI at 4G, at
the
4K,
same time.
At the same time, and it will output at 1080p through the HDMI.
Why do you need both?
Well, for example, if I want a monitor so that I can actually see what that camera is filming.
Because it doesn't have a viewfinder either, by the way.
There's no viewfinder, exactly. I could put a monitor next to it, and then I could still record in 4K.
In fact, that's what you're doing right here, right?
Yeah, this is the companion device. This is the video assist. And by the way, you can tell I'm Filipino because I still have the plastic on it. See, because now it's
plastic
no,
on your sofa.
It's
also
no longer new, Leo.
Oh,
what am I gonna do?
Oh man!
But this is a $900 device. It's not just a screen that will take in 4K. This actually is a recorder.
Interesting.
It's got two SD card slots, and it will record in ProRes HD.
Wow, that's what Final Cut uses. That's
exactly.
A good quality.
And this will record 4K, it will record 1080. It's got many inputs. I can record HDMI, so for example, I have recorded video game sessions off my console with this thing.
So is this 444, 422, what is it?
This is 422.
Oh, that's very good quality.
Yeah, it's incredibly good quality.
Very good quality.
It's the thing about Blackmagic is they've designed it not for the prosumer. These are all a little higher
These are
end.
Pro, yeah.
And yet
the price is, so how much for the body alone?
This body, if you were to buy it full price, would be $1,300.
Okay, that's like a camcorder.
It's a camcorder.
But you don't have a lens, you don't have a viewer,
right.
You don't have a recorder.
Right.
So you have to add all of that.
Yeah, because again, they're assuming that you're gonna be installing this in a studio, so you've got to be building out your studio.
Right.
This is $900, but they've also got a smaller version, a 5-inch version of the Assist that only records 1080p. It doesn't record 4K.
Okay.
That one goes for, I think it's $500.
But you know, a good monitor is an important thing when you're shooting, and
right.
It's better to have a big monitor than a little viewfinder on the camera. There's the little one.
And I will say, it's staggering to look at images through this monitor, because
really
here in the
good.
Studio, we have so many consumer-level TVs.
Yeah, yeah.
Our colors are always off.
This
is the color. It's color-corrected. This is what professionals want to look at. And this will even do things like I can do zebraing. I can see what the
overexposed
chroma looks like. Yeah, all
yeah.
the tools are built into this. Oh, and it's also a touchscreen, so it makes it kind of nice, easy to work with.
Battery life.
No. let's just say no. If I were to take the battery
again in a studio, it's going to be plugged in. Right?
It's going to be plugged in.
I think there are a lot of people would like to have both a field camera and a studio camera, right?
They have something for that. That's called the cinema.
So you should get the cinema if you're going to use it in the field.
Precisely, because the cinema you can actually record to the unit. It doesn't have a monitor. But they really designed it for this. They designed it for quadcopters.
Oh, interesting.
Because you can even control, pan, tilt, zoom, and record from your transmitter.
It's not much bigger, as you can see, than an action camera.
Right.
Something
right.
like the GoPro Hero. It's almost the same size, but the quality is much better.
Well, I think we actually do have some links to videos that Blackmagic provided to us that show off what some of their quality is. And it's staggering. I mean, when you do it right, when you get the right setting and the right glass, you can get once, like, look at the depth of field that you're getting on this. Look at when, you know, where I'm fixing my focus. It's this is a piece of kit that is not for beginners, because you have to choose what you're filming. There's so many cameras out there that are just turn it on and it will kind of give you everything. This lets you actually set your scene, and I love that. Now that I'm building up my own studio, that's what I want.
Yeah, these are at the price point now where we could almost replace our Canon Vixias, which are basically consumer-grade camcorders.
Well, we paid, what, $1,600?
At the time, they were $1,600. They're now $800.
$800 plus a $300
media converter.
We have
to get a converter on it. And
this
all
is
that, yeah.
You know, $1,300.
With SDI out.
With no media converter, because it's SDI out. Yeah. And what I've done with my studio is I've actually gotten a screens unit, which is a four-channel switcher that also streams out. So essentially, for under $3,000, I got a three-camera setup with one for my computer, so I can show my screen, that can stream out to YouTube Live, to Facebook,
that's
to
really
Twitch.
Great.
It's all under $3,000. I mean, can you imagine doing that 5 years ago?
Yeah, times have really changed. Every time Blackmagic releases something, it gets us excited. Yeah. Because they are aiming at a high-quality product for pros and prosumers at basically a consumer price, and they've really done a nice job with this. This is the micro studio camera, a 4K body that you then add features to. But it can use, if you've got Micro Four Thirds lenses, we're just using our old lenses.
I really wanted to see what this would look like with your $10,000 lens. But I mean,
I'd have
to
get
an adapter.
It doesn't. Yeah. $1,295 for the 4K camera, the body alone. If you want to get the video assist, which adds a recorder and a great display, HD is $459, 4K is $895. And if you're going out in the field, that's when you might want to get the cinema camera, and that's $1,000.
That's $1,000.
So it's less expensive.
And I will say, I went for open box, and I got the camera for $900, and I got the monitor for $600.
Oh, that's good.
And they were perfect.
Nothing wrong with it.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Very nice. Blackmagic. We use a lot of their gear in the studio anyway, including their switchers and their converters. I think this might be our... What do you think, Lisa? Next camera? No, she won't. She's not going to write a check.
Let's go over here.
Lisa. Thank you, Father Robert. Coming up, we've got a lot more, including the Bullet Journal and another call for help. But first, I want to talk to you a little bit about a little robot pal. I got to take you down to Mayfield Robotics, just down the road a piece in the Redwood City. They are making your first home robot. It's called Curry. And I love the design thinking behind Curry. It's a lot about what Curry doesn't do, as much about what it doesn't do as what Curry does do. It doesn't intimidate children. Curry's about as high as your knee, just a couple of feet high, has great speakers in the base, has four MEMS array microphones so it can listen to you, but it doesn't talk to you. She beeps and bloops, which is somehow a little more approachable.
Do you want to play?
She has face recognition. She knows who you are. She learns your house. She'll actually map your whole house, and then you can identify places. You can say, Curry, go to the living room, see if the dog's on the couch again. She's got a very high-quality, high-def camera in her left eye there, so she can go see the dog, send it back to your phone. She'll check out loud noises, send you pictures back so you always know what's going on. She'll not only be able to move around your home, she doesn't fall down the stairs or trip up on the carpet, but she can patrol your home. She has an autonomous patrol feature. And when she runs low on battery, she just goes back to the home dock and charges. You can do things like have Curry wake you up in the morning, play your favorite podcast, and then you can say, Curry, follow me. And then as you go brush your teeth or then walk into the kitchen to make the bacon, she'll follow you and continue to play the podcast. She follows along with conversations. So if there were three of us standing around in Redwood City and Curry joined the conversation, stood in the group, and looked back and forth as each person talked.
You went to the factory.
Yeah, we went down. Actually, I think these are going to be made in Germany. Mayfield Robotics that makes Curry is owned by Bosch, which is the big German manufacturer.
Of course,
so these are going to be very well made. The hardware design is pretty much done. The manufacture begins this fall. They're still tweaking the software because they want Curry to do a lot of interesting different things. If you're interested, find out more. Go to the website at heycurry.com, H-E-Y-K-U-R-I.com. But you can also put down, if you wish, a refundable $100 and get on the list, because you do want to be able to order Curry when she comes out. She'll be $5.99 remaining at time of shipping, excluding taxes and shipping. Of course, I immediately got on the list. I think this is one of those things where your kids will look back and say, oh, remember when we got Curry, the first, remember our first robot? She was, whatever happened to Curry? She's in the garage. Oh, she was so cute. Go get her out and charge her up. Let's play with Curry some more. Curry, heycurry.com, H-E-Y-K-U-R-I.com. That's, by the way, that conversation is like 2030, 2040. I'm projecting into the future.
We're living in the future.
We're living in the future. You are. You know what? You get Curry. People come over, you say, they'll say, oh, you're really living in the future. Heycurry.com. Well, we are all very digital, right?
Yes.
But there's some people, and I'm not against this, who still think paper is a good solution for certain things. Megan Morrone, for instance, loves her bullet journal. If you watch iOS today, you know she's showing it off all the time. She's here to show off a new companion app. I always say, if you lose your journal, you don't have a backup. How do you search it? Well, here's some good news. Here's the bullet companion app, Megan.
By now, you have no doubt heard me rave about my magic bullet. It's not my blender. It's my journal, my bullet journal. The bullet journal is not only a $25 paginated leather journal with dot grid paper and three attached cloth bookmarks. The bullet journal is a system. It's more than just creating and crossing out things from your to-do list. It's a system that encourages you to think not just about what's on your list, but why is it on your list? It encourages you to be more mindful of how you spend your days, your months, and your years. Now, I've tried Google Keep and Google Calendar and Evernote and Wunderlist and Remember the Milk and every other to-do list app that exists. Try me. I have tried them all. And what I found was that an app would not do. No apps would do. The bullet journal is an analog solution to my digital life. But now, there's an app for that. The Bullet Journal Companion helps remind you to spend time reflecting on your day in the morning and in the evening. Just set the time that's best for you to get a reminder notification. The app also includes inspiration from other bullet journalists with articles about modifications to the system that have worked for others. For example, some people don't even use bullets, and others have come up with novel ideas of how to track your habits that you're trying to build or tips on how to improve your handwriting. If you're just getting started with bullet journaling, there's also a guide to get you started and explanations of all the concepts, including my favorite, rapid logging, which is the best part of the process and what I think is the heart of what makes it work. It's easy and efficient, so you just keep doing it. The app also includes a link to the store and the ability to pay for the bullet journal straight from your iPhone with Apple Pay. But I have a secret for you. You don't have to buy a bullet journal to be a bullet journalist. Any journal will do. Any paper will do. And you don't even really need the app either, which costs $2.99. But I have learned so much from this process that I figured it wouldn't hurt to support its developer. So check it out online. I'm Megan Morrone. I host iOS Today every Monday at 1:30 Pacific. And I host Tech News Today every Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday on Tech News Today. And I do all that because of the bullet journal system.
I'm sorry. I'm just, I'm skeptical.
No.
I just want to put it on this. I don't...
Digital's digital.
Handwriting?
Sorry. I couldn't read my own handwriting. If I wrote a book in my head... No.
Let's go for another call for help. And as long as we're on the great island of the of England, let's stay in the area and go to Battersea in London. Mike's on the line with us. Hi, Mike.
Hi there, Leo. How are you doing?
I love your clock, sculpture, hard drive. What is that?
Oh, yeah. That's a series. I got a 16-year-old son, and he was asking about how the density of these drives have changed.
Oh.
So I think the bigger one at the bottom was a 20-meg drive that I bought probably in the mid-'80s for about, I think, $400 or something like that. And it gets smaller and smaller. And at the top one, there's like a little 1-inch drive, which is 20 gigabytes.
Wow.
Wait, that
obviously...
That is awesome.
That large one, was that RLL or MFM?
MFM for sure, yeah.
Oh, I don't know, yeah. But yeah,
Seagate, I remember those.
Probably RLL, actually, but yeah, I don't know. Yeah.
Run length encoding. Hey, I think you're an artist. I love that. But that is a functional piece of art. I love that. That's so neat.
Yeah, it's it feels like we try and we'll fill... Actually, my wife is an artist, so we try and fill all the walls with something. Yeah,
something so didactic. Yeah, well, what can we do for you today?
Well, I live in an old house built in about 120 years ago. We remodeled it a few years ago and put underfloor heating through the whole house. The consequence of that was that there's foil in between each floor.
Ah.
There's six floors.
Wow.
And so,
like metallic foil, metal foil?
Yeah. The insulation, you know, you put the underfloor heating on.
You couldn't put anything worse in your house to block Wi-Fi.
Well, As a consequence, so I've got a system which has evolved, let's say.
Yeah.
It's I've got a couple of routers, a couple of extenders, and I think it's about time I just jumped away from those things. And so I've been vaguely looking at things like Eero, Google Wi-Fi, Ubiquiti, and that kind of thing.
Right.
But I thought, you know, is there an open source system I should look at? You know, the one thing which I notice is I see Father Padre has got the Raspberry Pi 0W, which has a bit of Wi-Fi, or I wondered if I could buy like a few extenders, which are fairly cheap, and then put some open source software on them that gave me a mesh system.
I don't think this is something you're ever going to have a good open source solution for, but you correct me if I'm wrong.
You can absolutely do it open source. The problem is it's never going to work the way you want it to work, and it's going to cost more than buying a complete solution. But you could. I mean, if you wanted to practice, I wouldn't use the Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Pi doesn't quite have the horsepower that you need to make this work. But believe it or not, okay. WDS, which is what all these are going to use, it's a wireless distribution system.
Yep. That's not true, but go ahead.
Yeah, it goes back to this.
WDS is what you're using right now, Mike, which is the old school way of doing it.
Right, right.
The reason that these new mesh systems don't use WDS is that halves your bandwidth. Because if you think about it, you need a back channel between your main access point and your extenders. You need some way for them to talk so that it can talk to you. And in order to do that, it goes into duplex mode, which means you're going to get half the bandwidth, because half the time it's communicating with a wireless access point, half the time with you. That's what's different about these mesh systems, and they require a different kind of hardware. I don't know if anybody's selling. I mean, you know what the cheapest way to do it, if you really want to do it yourself? Go to Ubiquiti. They make this. This is the Amplify. This is a kind of consumer-grade version. But Ubiquiti, for under $100 U.S., sells their little Ubiquiti access points. For a long time, people didn't use these because you had to run Java on a personal computer to control them, set them up, and access them. They've changed that a little bit now. It's gotten a little more consumer-friendly. But these are a very inexpensive way to do true mesh. Ubiquiti's the pioneer in this. And do it yourself for less. I'm concerned about the metal foil, though, because even if you have one of these systems, it's predicated on the ability to get Wi-Fi through that ceiling, right? So,
I understand. Yeah.
One of the things that's great about these systems is
actually really wired as well. You know, so I can run.
Okay, so I want to show you something for that. Yeah. So again, you asked for open source, but we're showing you all the commercial solutions. Eero and a number of these other solutions, unfortunately, alas, not Ubiquiti, offer on their extenders Ethernet ports. So the best way, for instance, to use an Eero, if you've got Ethernet, is to plug it in. Eero will do the whole handoff thing, the whole thing about making it look like a single network, but each of them or many of them might have Ethernet connections. And that actually is the best way to use these mesh systems.
Mm-hmm.
The same thing with the Ubiquities, not the Amplify, but the Geek Ubiquities. They really want to be hardwired. They actually have power over an Ethernet in most of those, so that you don't have to have more than one cable giving it power and Ethernet. And that's probably for you, if you do have Ethernet going into each of the floors, the best way to do this.
Yeah.
So you're still one network. That's the beauty of the mesh part of this. It's still one network with one password, handoff. You know, your wife goes upstairs, she doesn't have to suddenly say, oh, I'm on the new network. She, from her point of view, it's all the same network. But you will plug in with Ethernet. This is another way you might want to do this. I haven't tried these yet. These just came out, or I just got them. Plume.
So pretty.
This is an interesting solution. These are much more like the Ubiquities. Each of these is $100. And the idea is you just plug it into the wall. But unlike Eero or Amplify or these other solutions, you'll need one per room of these.
That's actually good. Well, that's not a drawback, because you want small cell sizes. Small cell sizes give you more throughput.
Absolutely. And notice each of them has an Ethernet port. Of course, one will be the base unit. This has a high spousal acceptance factor. They come in a variety of colors. This is the Onyx, but it's silver. These don't look bad. You plug those into the wall. And it doesn't look like you've put gear all over the house, right, with wires and so forth. These are very attractive. And the idea of this, there's a couple of things with Wi-Fi you've got to remember. In fact, I highly recommend a wonderful article, came out about a week ago in Ars Technica. I'll have to find the name of the author, about Wi-Fi is so bad.
Yep.
Why Wi-Fi is so bad. And part of the problem is 2.4 gigahertz goes through walls. And Wi-Fi is a collision-based network. When if you can see any other access points in your house, your neighbor's access points in your house, that means you're all sharing those frequencies. And when they're transmitting, your access point shuts up. It stops. Yep, yep. And waits.
No, I have to change the channels on a regular basis. You know, and I look at the freest channel.
But yeah. Which channels do you use?
He has more choices than we do.
Which ones? It depends. I tend to go to through 9 or 2, 4, 2. That sort of.
There's
on the
only
2.4
one. There's only three channels you should
yeah,
use.
Yeah, it looks
one,
like
6 and 11.
It looks like there's 11 in the U.S. You have more, but it looks like there's 11. But really, it's three bands with three each. You know.
Yeah.
Anyway,
yeah.
The nice thing about all the mesh solutions is you don't have to ever think about channels. You don't even have to think about frequency. Almost all of them will do both 2.4 and 5. Mm-hmm. They'll pick it appropriately. They'll hand it off. They'll move it around. 5 is often better because it doesn't go as far, right? 5 is probably definitely stopped by your metal foil in there because 5 is at a higher frequency. As you know, the higher the frequency, the more it bounces off. That's actually a good thing because, as you said, you want to limit interference from outside world. Same. You want it simple. So I've heard good things. I'm going to try these in the house. My wife, my poor wife. you know my secret is? I don't change the name of the SSID or the password. So she doesn't have to know that we are in a completely different system.
Yeah. I like that, though. SAF. Spousal acceptance factor should be included on all the specs.
Well, don't you think these are beautiful? But you have to, the downside is you have to buy one of these for each
UK.
Room.
I'd have to check on Amazon where they do a UK or...
and that's a big thing, isn't it?
240 volts.
Yeah.
So I wanted to install these, but I'm pretty sure that the SAF on these are probably not nearly as good
now,
as those.
Now, we were really excited about this when you brought this by. This is an enterprise grade.
Bumps, yeah.
Yeah.
This is a Zerus array. So inside of this, there are actually 8 radios, dual band, so 2.4 and 5 gigahertz. I have used this to set up a mesh. And what I'll do is I avoid the problem of WDS because I use one set of radios, the 5 gigahertz radios, to do the backhaul. And then the 2.4 gigahertz distributes to the clients. But as Leo mentioned, your house is wired. And if your house is wired, there is absolutely no reason to do a mesh.
These would be great because you just plug them in where they need to be. And you could forget about it. By the time, this is $99 in the US. By the time you got the open source solution hardware, got it all configured, it's going to cost you at least $100 per room.
Yeah,
right?
And a lot of time.
And a lot of time. And it's not going to be robust. The good news about these mesh systems is they automatically update. You know, our Eero is, you know, updated. It feels like almost every day. It doesn't, you don't have to think about it. I only notice it because I look on the app. And that means they're improving it, adding capabilities. They completely changed the mesh algorithm a couple of months ago and went to mesh 2.0. So the nice thing is all the security, everything's being updated. You don't want to be responsible for that.
Yeah.
And I think that letting Eero or, you know, Plume or Ubiquiti or who else? There's just a ton of these. Google, the Google Home. I can't use all of these. I don't like to have more than one Wi-Fi network in the house. So I gave the Google Homes to my daughter. They're working great, and she's in a very congested area. I could see 20 or 30 Wi-Fi signals. And the nice thing is these guys, they figure out, you know, what's frequency, what they do the channel automatically, but even what frequency automatically, and they do a handoff. A lot of access points you'll see, you have three, like I have a tri-band ASUS. So I have three different networks. I have a ASUS 1, 2, and 3, and you shoot. No, these do it all automatically. So. You know, maybe there is an open source solution. If you're using something, let us know. I'd love to show that off. But I have to say,
you've got it, Leo.
You're benefiting from all the work that these
guys are doing. Yeah, I think you've sold me. Yeah, it's probably better to spend my retirement money getting a commercial solution.
Yeah, I mean, so the Plumes, I haven't tried these, but I'm hearing very good things about it because it is such a limited cell. I think, you know, if you could put it where you need it, and it doesn't get interfered with, I think that's really going to be the best.
Oh, that's perfect.
Yeah, can't wait to try
great.
These. Sorry, honey. I'm ripping it all out again. My poor wife. She sees me carrying this stuff. She goes, what are you doing? What are you up to? What's going on? Don't worry. It's still the same.
I always need to keep one of the Wi-Fi networks just for my son, which is untouched.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. That's the kids' network. Yeah.
Yeah, the rest can change. Yeah.
So nice to talk to you. I want to, next time you're on, bring more of your wife's art. I love that. I think that's wonderful.
That's not hers. That's mine. Yeah,
you
she's
did that.
An illustrator.
Oh,
yeah.
Nice.
That was just a spare afternoon. I did that. Yeah.
I think that's so cool. How old is your son now?
Oh, he's 16.
Oh.
Yeah, so we had him a little bit late, yeah. And, oh, yeah. By the way, 4,000 potholes in Lancashire. We have 4,000 potholes on the roads of Battersea as well.
That's where that came from. John Lennon was reading a newspaper, and that was one of the stories, was there were 4,000 potholes in, and that's where this was fascinating. But I don't think
our local landmark is Battersea Power Station, which features on Pink Floyd, the Animals album. I don't know.
I totally know it, of course. The Stacks.
Yeah,
with the pink pig. Yes.
Yeah, that's going. I don't know if you know. That's going to be Apple are moving in there in a year or two to consolidate all their UK offices
into the Battersea Power Station. So it's been decommissioned.
They decommissioned about 30 years ago, and various property developers have been trying to do things for a long, long time with it. But finally, it's now being redeveloped as offices and retail.
There's a certain irony to this company that's doing solar everywhere, clean power, moving into a coal-powered power station. That's cool.
It's the circle of life, Lee.
Yeah. It's the circle of life.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you very much for that. That was
nice to talk to you, Mike. Yeah, I appreciate it. All right, take care.
All the best.
Yeah, I do think if I had more energy, I might spend time with the Ubiquiti Enterprise.
It's fun
stuff.
I like playing with it, but when I deploy it, I just want it to work.
It's a pain
in the
butt.
I don't want to have to troubleshoot it.
Yeah, I'm very intrigued by these.
I want to see.
Look cool too? Yeah. I mean, that's really neat. Next week, Nathan Oliveras Giles, our newest employee at Twit, will be our guest host. You want to ask a question of Nathan? You can ask him about gaming. He's got the Nintendo Switch. He's he's knowledgeable about so many things. Here's how you can be on the show.
Need tech help? The new screensavers are here with answers. Email your tech questions to newscreensavers@twit.tv.
All right, it's not working, but we're going to show it to you anyway. happened? It was working last night.
It was working last night. It was working when I came into the studio, and I think I may have just static discharged it and blown it up.
Well, that's an important point to make. Now, this is the $10 Raspberry Pi Zero W. Now, the zero was $5. Why pay $5 more? It's doubled in price for the W.
Yeah, well, because it gets rid of one of the biggest problems with the original Raspberry Pi Zero, which is I only have that one OTG connector to connect everything I need to connect to my Pi. That means my USB keyboard, my USB mouse, maybe a network adapter, maybe a Wi-Fi dongle, maybe a Bluetooth dongle. So what they've done is they've taken the wireless component from the Raspberry Pi 3, and they've added it to the Zero. So this now gives me Wi-Fi and Bluetooth out of the box.
That is kind of amazing. Of course, memory is served by this micro SD card. That's
correct.
Your operating system in boot. Why does it have two USB connectors?
Well, because this one is just power. So that only powers the unit.
That's your power dongle.
And this one is designed for OTG devices.
On the go.
That
means that you can use a memory device as a storage. Right?
Well, yes.
Or vice versa.
It was designed for like the micro USB phone. So,
right.
Because I can use it as both a client and a host,
right.
What I was able to do is to hook this up to a USB hub, and then I can plug in all the different preferred phones.
Yeah, traditionally, USB has one smart end and one dumb end.
Right.
But OTG allows a kind of a swapping of roles.
Should also mention that this is not regular HDMI. If you look at this, this is full-size HDMI. That won't quite fit.
No.
You need this, which is the mini HDMI.
Is that a standard?
It is a standard.
Okay.
It was used a lot on the Canon camcorders we have here.
Yeah, so you can go to Mono Price and get the adapter for that.
Precisely.
All right.
Now, they didn't up the specs of the unit at all. It's still 1 GHz single core versus, say, the Raspberry Pi 3, which is a quad core processor. So this is much more slow. 512 megabytes of memory versus 1 GB for the Raspberry Pi 3. It's got that mini HDMI port. It's got the micro USB. It's got a camera connector, and it actually has in the case that they've included this one. So this one is designed so that you can snap this into the case like this.
Look how small this thing is.
Yeah, and actually get the one with the case because it actually is really made quite well. And if I had kept it in the case, I probably wouldn't have zapped it.
Yeah, that's kind of an important point.
Hold on, wait. There we go. So if I do this, I could install the camera module on the top here. They give me
is
the
that
little
small?
Ribbon cable. Oh yeah, it's tiny.
Wow. And it still has GPIO on there.
Would actually
so you have
be the
all
camera.
So it's really a full Raspberry Pi with just some minor sacrifices.
Yeah.
And for $10.
I get the GPIO header, and this is you can use this with the hat, the sensing hat that they have for the Raspberry Pi, both on the top and
look
on
that.
The bottom. It's it's kind of elegantly designed. I just wish I hadn't blown it up.
Is it really? I thought you got it working again.
Momentarily.
Yeah.
I'm not going to try to troubleshoot it on the air. But here's the thing about this. People have been asking me, oh, can I use a Raspberry Zero to install MAME? Or can I use it for, say, my media streaming?
It
would be horribly, horribly slow. Yeah. It would be like the Raspberry 1,
right,
which is not great. What this is really designed for is for people who want to make Internet of Things things. That's what they've told you. And actually, I found a really good place for people to do that, just to play around with. Do you have my screen, Anthony? Because if you have my screen, this is a tool that we had on This Week in Enterprise Tech not too long ago. It's called Cayenne from My Devices. And what it allows you to do is to make a secure Internet of Things device and just choose what you want it to do. So for example, I have a Raspberry Pi at home that I disconnected because I had to come over here. But I can make it so that it would do like an IFTTT type thing. So I've got a motion sensor set up to it. I can say, okay, if you detect motion between the times of 8 o'clock in the morning and 5 o'clock at night, send me a text message. Or activate a light on a different Raspberry Pi. This also works on Arduino, and the code is auto-generated. I don't have to really do any setup. All I'd have to do is send my Raspberry Pi to an address or copy and paste a snippet of code into my Arduino sketch, and suddenly I have an Internet of Things device that runs off of Amazon. It's fantastic. I mean, when you think of all the bad stories about Internet of Things devices, it's because you take the device and you put it on the internet and then it gets owned, of course.
Right.
This sits behind your network, doesn't have to touch the public internet, and it just communicates to a server that's up in the cloud. That's what actually accesses the internet. That's what actually gets hit. Much better way to do it, and much simpler.
And I just love, at $10 and the size, you could make, I always think of these as a great solution for a picture, an animated picture frame, right?
It's perfect for that.
You could glue this on the back of a television screen, a cheap screen, and it would, with Wi-Fi, it would be able to pick up images, and you could make this for grandma and put it in her living room, and she'd be getting pictures of the kids automatically. At $10!
And it runs Raspbian, so it's running the same OS that you can run on the big ones.
It's the full Raspbian OS.
It's the full Raspbian. Does run a little sluggish because I'm used to it on the 3 now.
Yeah.
But it works just the same. It would really be,
as you said, for IoT. It would really not be for general purpose.
No.
You would want to program it, have it do one thing, and just keep doing that over and over.
For example, your picture frame. This would be perfect for a picture frame. You do a Python script that looks at a folder, a shared folder on the device that's stored on the micro SD card that you dump pictures into, and it will just take the next picture and the next picture.
Yeah.
That's perfect
simple.
For this.
Yeah, very
one
simple.
Use, one thing. Very simple device.
So can we get it? That's the other problem.
Yes and no. Yes, you can order it. No, you will not get it.
This happened last time. It happens every time they announce a new Raspberry Pi. There's such a big community of people who want Raspberry Pis who can't wait to get one. It takes a few months for the pipeline to fill, and then you'll have no trouble getting it.
Just wait.
Yeah.
Because if you buy it now, the only way you're going to be able to buy one of these things is if you buy it in a bundle. So they'll bundle it with $60 worth of stuff you don't need. Wait a month or two. It'll come down to $15. In 3 or 4 months, it'll be down to actually $10, and then buy a bunch.
Yeah. And, of course, you can get it from Raspberry Pi, but Adafruit and all the usual suspects have orders for them.
Or you could buy it on Amazon for twice the price.
Really? Oh, yeah, that's sad. No, get it from Adafruit or a company that, you know, respects open source and helps you and does good stuff. And they often have great kits, too. Very nice. The Raspberry Pi Zero W for Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, just $10. Are you ready for a couple of final emails and we can wrap this thing up?
Yeah.
All right, I counted these. I know there's 6. I don't want any missing, all right? I got my eye on you. All right, there's 6. I know. It's like the spoons. All right, let's head over to the fireplace. I'm ready for a little warmth.
Can I hear a story, Uncle Leo?
Yes. Once upon a time, there was a priest named Robert.
Ah, we're going to turn on the heat. Ah, that's very good. It's always fun to have you. Thank you for coming on, and thank you for the great job you do on This Week in Enterprise Tech and know-how. When are we going to lose you?
Not for a while. So you will lose me for 2 months starting about the second week of June.
And this is part of your vocation as a priest.
Right.
Something you need to do.
I have to do. I will be off the grid for 2 months, which, remember, this was all changed because originally they were going to let me do TWIT for 1 year.
Right.
And then they kind of liked it.
That was about 3 years ago.
That was, 3 years back. They liked it. They actually said, okay, this is good for us.
Good.
So they let me keep doing it. And they even modified what we call the tertianship. I was originally going to be off the grid for 9 months straight. And they split it up so I can do like 2 months, 2 months, 2 months.
How many have you already done?
This will be the first 2 months. So I'm just starting.
And is this the one where you're going to Malta to do this? Where are you going to do this?
No, that's...
That's something else.
That's
different. He's not going to Malta.
That's secret.
Don't worry. He's not coming.
I'm not going to Malta.
So forget I said that, but where are you going to do your, what do you call it, tertianship?
Tertianship. I decided I wanted to go someplace exotic. I wanted to go someplace where I've never been before, someplace where the customs were, you know, that would cause me to adjust, to adapt.
Open your mind.
Open my mind.
Yeah,
so
where's that?
Going to Portland.
have a wonderful time in Portland. Let's get the mailbag out here. When is that going to happen? Do we know?
June.
So, but that's one of the reasons we brought in Nathan. We thought
right.
He could help you out, fill in and stuff like that. Oh, it's a boy.
Aww,
we got the birth announcements.
Look at that.
So
he's so happy.
I don't know if Nathan's going to like that so much.
Oh, but we skipped all the college years.
Thank God. No. Sorry, you got me now. All right, pick an envelope.
I'll do this one.
All right, there all we right. go. The winner is L.A. La La Land. Okay, no. Was that wild?
Too soon.
Is it too soon? Maybe
too
it is.
Too soon.
Let's close the door on that. Okay. Here's question one from Pete the Trucker. Hello, Pete. Thanks for everything you've taught me over the years. My question is, how can I get in touch with a maker? Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, that's cool.
I have an idea that I think would be awesome, combining the internals of a Chromebook with the body of a clamshell iMac, making it a fast, stylish, and retro PC. I would be the envy of all my non-geeky friends and family. Thanks again for your awesome work, Pete the Trucker. Now, I have to say, you could be the maker,
yes.
Right? How hard would it be? First, you'd have to get an iMac.
I'm assuming he has a clamshell iMac.
Okay.
One of these. This, okay, here's the issue.
And I don't know, is it the iBook? I guess it's the iBook. He says iMac, but I think you're right. I think it's the iBook.
Because I don't think there's a clamshell.
That's the one John C. Dvorak said looked like a toilet.
It kind of
toilet.
Actually,
lid.
Now that I look at it, or that's the drop down tray on a plane.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I know people think, oh, it's an LCD display. I can just hook it up to my other thing that uses an LCD display.
Yeah.
Not so much.
Okay.
I mean, it's actually the wiring harnesses are really kind of specific to the device that they
built. So you would need a maker, somebody who could modify that or make an adapter for the... Because you could take the logic board out.
Yes.
You could put something in there, not a Raspberry Pi, but something
maybe
a little bit more. What are there things with more oomph? Like the Edison, maybe? The Intel Edison?
The Intel Edison, it's a higher-end processor. You could probably get a bit more oomph, but even that probably wouldn't equal the original power of the iPhone.
What if you took an old iPhone apart?
Or an
Android device? That would give you enough
absolutely
horsepower
more,
to
absolutely
run.
More. But then the question would be interfacing with that LCD screen. There are a couple of kits that will let you do that. They actually have a board with two plugs. One you plug in your iBook connector, and then the other side would be like an HDMI out or HDMI in. But those are kind of clunky. They don't always work right. A lot of the reviews were saying it worked fine for the first 3 months and then died. What you could probably do if the iBook was still working and you're willing to play around with changing the firmware, you could get it to run a version of Linux?
No, we want Chrome OS. So here's the next suggestion. Go to a makerspace near you. There are makerspaces everywhere. You've seen Aaron Newcomb come in here. He runs the Benicia makerspace. If you go to the Make website, you can actually see that article there. What is a makerspace and a directory of makerspaces? There are plenty of makers there. And I would say just put a notice up on the bulletin board saying, I'm willing to pay some. I have a clamshell iBook. And I'm willing to pay somebody $100 to turn it into a Chromebook, and I bet you'll get some takers. Maybe not for $100. I made that price up, but you'd certainly
actually you could do it.
This is the kind of thing that inspires makers, right?
This is going to sound really, really stupid, but if he really wants the geek cred of having it in the clamshell iBook, the cheapest way to do it and the fastest way to do it would be to buy a $100 Chromebook, remove all the internals, and then install that into the shell.
That would work great.
And actually, that does require quite a bit of making skill to make it look right.
Yeah.
But by and far, you will
start with the Chromebook.
Start with the Chromebook.
Yeah.
Because then you don't have to do any weird conversions. You don't have to worry about jamming
it. Maybe even not even a Chromebook. Maybe a Chrome box, which are like the little small, like like Apple's Mac Mini, but it's just for Chrome OS. And it doesn't have a screen.
Yeah.
So then maybe you could make that work. Anyway, a maker will know we'll have some ideas. And makers are always, because makers do it because they like to make. So they're always looking for projects, right? I know if we told this to Aaron Newcomb, we go, oh, and he'd start just like you did because you're a maker too. Right. Well, you could, and then, and by the time they're done, you're going to have an interesting Chromebook.
I was exactly where he was. I had a bunch of old laptops, and I'm like, I bet I could interface something with the screen. You could. It just takes forever, and it never
I like
works
the idea. Take a Chromebook and put it in that enclosure. What do you got? Did you throw yours away?
No, I got one right here. This is very important from, of course, Jason, who says, I am a producer for a pro wrestling company. And Leo's got the visual aids for me. And right now we have 2 to 3 camera setup with another computer recording commentary. Then I take it back and on my MacBook Pro, put the feeds together and the separate voice only track and put it together in a TV show with lower thirds. I don't have Leo money to get a TriCaster, but need a solution where I could do it all live on a budget.
Interesting. How would you solve that?
I didn't know the Niners had a luchador.
Yes, they do.
This is so what's your wrestling name? Uncle Leo-us.
Montana the Handler? I don't know. Uncle Leo.
So someone in the chat room
needs
a
wrestling. Perfect guy to ask this, by the way.
Yeah, because we just did it.
Yeah.
Actually, this
this
was
on Know How.
Literally, this was 2 days ago on Know How we did this because we started with the $3,000 studio. We're taking Twit and trying to rebuild it for $3,000. We ended with we know people don't have $3,000 sometimes, so we built a $1,000 solution. Then we built a $400 solution.
Okay, now that's not Leo money. You're talking.
Now we're talking, and the way to do it is to use one of the free broadcasting software suites. Now, there's a couple that I could recommend. OBS, which is the Open Broadcast, that works incredibly well, but it requires a little bit of firepower to make it look right. OBS Studio, here it is.
This is what's used heavily by Twitch and other gamers who are doing Let's Play videos.
Precisely. So
they're streaming their game and themselves inset in the game, and almost to a man, they use OBS, the Open Broadcast System.
Now, I used an early version of OBS that crashed a lot, and that really bothered me because if you're in the middle of a broadcast, especially a live event, you can't crash at all. It's unacceptable.
Yeah.
So what I started using, and this is also a favorite of the Twitch crowd, is something called XSplit. And XSplit is a fantastic way to do this for next to nothing. If you have a laptop that has an i7 processor and 8 gigabytes of memory, you've got enough to do broadcaster. Maybe not gamecaster, but broadcaster. And then connect 3 USB webcams or a couple of USB to HDMI type converters, and you have a very easy way to set screens. And just like we do with a TriCaster, move from one scene to another scene. I can use different audio sources, different video sources. I can layer them together. I can drop one window on top of another. And again, this software is completely free. I have never, ever crashed a session of XSplit, which is why I trust it over some of the
Interesting.
Others.
Yeah, if you think about what our switcher is, we use something called the TriCaster, mm-hmm. as we mentioned, from NewTek. It's a PC at its heart, running Windows, and it has additional hardware boards that allow us to connect inputs in, and then it's running some custom software on top of Windows that does the switching. You can start at a few $1,000s. Ours, I think, was $25,000, Alex? $30,000?
40,000? Higher!
40,000?
Higher!
It's expensive. But we're doing a lot with the TriCaster. Solutions like XSplit and OBS take your stock PC, mm-hmm. add software to it. You still have to solve the hardware.
Yes, right.
What about the Blackmagic? Don't they have a television studio?
The ATEM.
ATEM.
It is fantastic. It is wonderful. It's $1,200, which is that's not breaking the bank money.
But that's a hardware switcher.
That's a hardware switcher. One thing with the ATEM, I won't use this as a knock, but if you're not using Blackmagic parts,
made for Blackmagic,
you will always find these weird problems, things that don't work. Now, like for example, I'm using the 4K cameras.
Yeah.
It is perfect. Those go straight in.
Yeah.
You can actually control all the functions of the camera from your switcher.
But now you're talking Leo money.
Now we're talking Leo money. Well, no, this is young Leo money. Young Leo money. We're not
young Leo money.
You can still do this all for under $5,000. And the nice thing about that is, in addition to streaming it live, you can record that session locally so that you could remix it and remaster it later on if something didn't go right during the live stream.
Beatmaster's mentioning, because we know he already has a MacBook, why doesn't he just put Wirecast, which is Mac software, on top of the MacBook, and then he could connect USB cameras, kind of like XSplit. Do you like XSplit better than Wirecast?
Yes. Wirecast, that was actually the very very first setup I tried, even before OBS, that thing crashed probably every other broadcast.
Yeah.
And I, you know, it's one of these things, once bitten, twice shy.
Right.
If you mess up my broadcast, I don't want to use you anymore.
We use Wirecast here for kind of weird things, right?
The VidBlaster for the longest time, right?
Oh, VidBlaster.
Yeah, it was Wirecast.
Yeah. Do we still use VidBlaster, Alex? No, he says we don't. We used to do the picture-in-picture and the double box and those things using VidBlaster. So we've gotten beyond that. Because I think the TriCaster does it all natively now. We don't need to get any third-party stuff. You know, that's kind of one of the things that happened here was we started at a very simple... Mm-hmm. I mean, when it first began, I wasn't even video... We weren't video streaming. I had a little, you know, one of those 8-ball cameras from Logitech... And I'd send a picture out every 10 seconds, and that was all we did.
Didn't you send out like 100 of those from the tech TV days?
Might have.
Thousands of them?
Maybe.
They were serial, parallel or serial
Those were
connected?
The 3COM net cams.
Oh, those were horrible.
Those were terrible. And yeah, probably they were because I don't think USB was out by then.
Nope.
So they probably were. We were still, it wasn't, Windows 95 was out. That had USB support, so it might have been USB. But yeah, we were very early days. I think it was serial.
Not early. Serial. You were on the edge.
But even at Twit, I mean, we started in a very simple way, and you just slowly get better at it. You hire people who know what they're doing, and you acquire enough, you know, advertising support that you can start to buy better and better stuff. And at this point, I think we're probably doing what a broadcast quality stream, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I will say this, though. If they want to get to the Leo space, if eventually they're thinking, yeah, that's where we want to end up, then that should guide your purchase because you don't want to buy a bunch of stuff that you're just going to have to discard.
Yeah.
You know, spend a bit more money on the cameras so that you get something like the Blackmagics that I'm going to use those for 10 years.
I remember we went back and forth because Alex Lindsay said, do not buy a software switcher, get a hardware switcher. Hardware is reliable, hardware doesn't crash. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't afford, because at the time there was no ATEM, a hardware switcher. So we ended up going with the inexpensive TriCaster. And that's one of the reasons we're with TriCaster. Yep. We never stopped. And we just, the nice thing is TriCaster got better and better. As we needed more and more, we were able to add to the capabilities very easily. And nowadays, here we are 12 years later, really there are great solutions out there in almost any price range. So this decision is a lot easier than it used to be.
This, you are part of the grand circle of broadcasting life. It used to be you needed a million and plus to have a studio. You proved that you could do it for much less, and now there are solutions out there where I could carry it in my backpack and spend less than $1,000.
You know, my son is taking broadcast journalism classes at CU Boulder. I shouldn't say where because I don't want to get him in trouble. But they have, because, you know, whatever it was, Channel 8 Denver decommissioned their set, their cameras, 10 years ago, so they have the equivalent of a 10-year-old television studio. And Henry bitches and moans because he says, we're using these old cameras, they're not even high def, and we're learning how to use these cameras, you know, the old studio ped cameras. And I have to tell him, Henry, those are $20,000, $30,000 cameras in the time. And now we're using $800 Blackmagic cameras that are better quality, easier to use. I said, learn how to do it that way. You'll never lose because you'll know how it used to be. In the old days. It's so great to have you. Thank you, Father Robert.
Thank you for having me. I love doing this show because, you know, this is what you wanted. When you started the experiment that was Twit, you just wanted to let people in to your life.
We kind of wanted to get to this point.
Yeah.
Now I can just stop.
I think you're done.
We're done. Yeah. You'll catch Robert on This Week in Enterprise Tech every week and a couple of times a week now for Know How with Brian Burnett. And I hope we'll see a lot more of you before your tertianship in June. And
then you'll be back. I'm pre-recording a lot of content.
Good.
So even though I won't be here, I'll be on the stream somewhere.
Very good. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Thank you for all your questions. We do the show every Saturday right after the radio show, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern time. That's going to change. Actually, I'll give you the new times. No, that's not going to change.
Wait.
It's going to stay the same. But what's going to change is UTC... Because it'll now be 2200 UTC, not 2300. Because tomorrow in the United States, we are going to go back in time and spring forward. We're going to go forward in time and spring back.
Falling, I fall, fall my face and spring.
We're going to our summertime tomorrow at 2 in the morning. And that means that we don't change. And every time I say this, people say, well, you know, UTC doesn't change. I know. Because what's happening is we change. But from our point of view, the clock, because we set it before.
Leo, all I know, all this means to me is that for the next couple of months, the clock in my car is going to be wrong.
It's going to be wrong. Blinking 12.
That's it. That's all the changes.
3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern time. And if you want to do the conversion for summertime, has been 2300 UTC. Starting next week, 2200 UTC. You can also join us in studio. Email us tickets at twit.tv. We'd love to get you in studio. You can also join us in the chat room if you watch the live stream, irc.twit.tv, and on-demand audio and video of everything we do is available at the website, twit.tv/thisweekintech, or on YouTube, or on your favorite podcast application. Please do me a favor and subscribe. That way we know you'll get every single episode. You won't miss an episode. It'll always be available to you on your phone. There's audio and video. And it kind of makes us feel better to see those subscriber numbers going up. So thank you. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time on the new Screensavers. Bye-bye. Yay! Woohoo! The bars close an hour early.